The other changes in Schedules 2 through 5 simply conform the state schedules to recent changes made by the federal government. Two of the most commonly abused prescription drugs are the drug Vicodin, which you may have heard of in New York, Fentanyl, and the feds have taken scheduling action on those drugs. And right now, the reason this became a general register on welfare is the purpose of this bill is really a law enforcement purpose, because pharmacies and prescribers for Schedule 2 through 5 drugs, they already need to obey or follow the federal schedules. So it's actually county prosecutors and law enforcement offices that you get calls about to get these drugs scheduled in conformity with federal schedules, because if they find somebody, they stop somebody for a traffic stop, and they find a loose bag of Vicodin, they can't charge the person under state law, even though it's very clear to them that this person illegally obtained the drugs.
Okay, I'm going to move over to the question. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Representative Barrett, for bringing this bill forward. Myself and Representative Wola and Representative Sean, who's here shortly, I would assume, I will also serve on the Synthetic Drug Task Force the last session. It was an honor to serve on that, and moving synthetic drugs to Schedule 1 is a big step forward in keeping our kids safe. So thank you for doing this.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So when you put together this list, we approve it every year. I think it's great. There just was a story on the news about law enforcement saying that there was a gap in some of the drugs not being listed on these schedules so that they couldn't prosecute them for DWIs. Do you have conversations with them about where those gaps are to make sure they end up on these lists?
Mr. Chair, we primarily, especially with the street drugs, we primarily find out what street drugs are out there because of the contacts we have with law enforcement. So on a fairly regular basis, we get calls directly from police departments or county sheriff departments, and we have a lot of communication with the Bureau of Criminal Apprehension in terms of the drugs that have been seized by law enforcement and that they analyze. So we're constantly in contact with them as well.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So do you believe that you've got them all covered at this point, so we don't have that gap any longer, or do we still need to fix something else?
Mr. Chair, Representative Wilstrom, we've got covered what we know about right now. This is a constant threat we have, but the board does have limited authority. If you could go in, when the legislature is not in session, and do this as well, and we try to do that as well.
Any other questions, members? Do you have any other testifiers?
Thank you, Don.
Any other representative board?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To the testifiers, please. I just want to understand for sure that you're not feeling there are any gaps. This covers a broad definition of synthetic drugs, is that right? Or how's that covered?
Yeah. Mr. Chair, Representative, basically, we've added, I think, close to a dozen new synthetic cannabinoids, hallucinogens, and stimulants, and these are the ones that have been reported to the board over the last year or so by law enforcement and the Bureau of Criminal Apprehension. The problem with the synthetic drugs has always been that as soon as you list something in the schedule, some enterprising, what we call bathtub chemist out there, tries to tweak the molecule just a little bit so it's not in the schedule. However, we also, several sessions ago, added what's called an analog provision. So I just talked to a county prosecutor last week, and there's a drug called butyryl fentanyl that's not specifically listed. It's not in this bill yet. But it is definitely an analog. And so I explained to that prosecutor that because it is an analog of something that's already in the schedule, it automatically becomes a Schedule 1 drug. So he could prosecute.
Representative Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Dr. Weiber, I think what you do,
position like all of us learn by technology. By the time you get it on the screen, by the time it hits the car, or you can buy it, it's outdated. And I think this is the problem that you have. As soon as you get legislation here, or make a rule, the very next day somebody's going to have something that changes or doesn't fall under that rule at all.
That is true. That can happen. I would say more just from anecdotal reports I'm getting back from law enforcement that one of the things that's happened in the state, partially I think as a result of legislation like this in previous sessions, partially probably as a result of the successful prosecution in Duluth, is that it appears that there are less retail sales of these drugs, you know, at tobacco shops and things like that within the state. The problem that we still have, it's difficult for any state government to do friendly, it's difficult for the federal government to do, and that's internet sales. So that's, I think, one of the problems we're having is working their algorithm on the internet getting some of these drugs.
Okay. Any public testimony? If not, Representative Newberger renews this motion. House File 1376, move for the general rights. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much. Representative Mahoney, House File 446.
House File 446 deals with the income tax dependency exemptions. The courts, if two people are have a child and one has a substantially different income and does not have 50% plus one of the custody of the child in calendar year, they are not supposed to get the tax exemption. What this does, and of course, I've made it out of workaround because it's not really much sense to giving the tax exemption to that person who needs the least amount of income if there is any grant. Of course, I've figured out a workaround, but it's never good to do a workaround and not have kind of a detail on how you do it. And what 446 does is gives that detail to the courts. And after all, the House research is fairly simple. As I explained in Section 1, that's what this bill is doing. Paragraph B provides the court must consider and determine how we determine the allotment. Paragraph C provides a place for the court to place conditions on the party's right to claim this exemption. Paragraph D states that absence an agreement by the parties apparently less than 10% guaranteed time is not entitled. Paragraph E requires a showing of substantial change in factors associated with B, D for the allotment can be modified. F requires the court to make findings in its right itself. And G establishes a remedy for the parties claiming exemption in violation of a court order or applicable law or fails or refuses to provide the properly executed declaration using parties claim to the child as independent. Mr. Chair, very simple bill, that's the cleanup for the courts. It gives them direction and allows the parties to have a little explanation.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Mahoney, this is part of the working group's agreement, is that correct?
Okay. That is correct, Mr. Chair and Representative Hillstrom. for those that do don't know, a couple of years ago, a bill was passed, not cleared by the governor. The governor asked us, asked the parties all to get together. There was no state or state funds involved in it in any way. Very minimal if there was. 35, 40 people came together from all sides, proponents of shared people, shared custody, and those heavily opponents of that. And the result is a variety of bills coming forth. This is part of it. As someone who's worked on it for 12 years, I was very grateful to take a couple of the easier bills. The really tough bills should be still out there and still working on and moving through. Shared parenting did not come through the agreement group, and we found places to make it simpler and better for families trying to figure out how to raise children when they're apart. And I think this is part of that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Mahoney, as part of this group, did you have conversations about, you know, sometimes if one parent makes additional money and the other parent doesn't, sometimes that other parent qualifies for other services, maybe child care assistance or maybe some other kinds of things. Did you have those conversations as part of this?
We had some of those conversations, that's correct. That's really not, that's only a small piece of this particular bill that where it came from, but that wasn't part of this. This does not make any changes to the 518B child support guidelines or child support law.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, to Representative Mahoney. So when I look at this, I do what most people do. I go back to myself and how I was impacted on this. And my former wife and I agreed that every other year we would do the deduction portion. So does this in any way impact that at all?
Representative Chair, no, it should not. If you come to an agreement, of course, would more often than not, unless there's some power differentiation or the court perceives that it is a an adverse kind of settlement, if you come to the agreement that it's every other year, many people have that, they would give it their blessing, so to speak, and then they move on and get out of their room.
No other questions yet. Any testimony from the public? Seeing none, then Chair will renew his motion to pass health file 446 and order the agenda. Motion, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thank you, Representative.
Chair, thank you.
And Representative Garofalo here yet? If not, we'll move on to Representative Newberger. Come back to Representative Garofalo when we're done.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members.
Representative Newberger, you want to move your bill and understand what it's going
to do? I was going to taxes. I think that's the next step.
All right, you go ahead and move your bill.
I'd like to move House File 1463. So pass this to the next step, which would be taxes.
Okay, inclusion.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. What House File 1463 is, simply reaches out to people that are in the life saving business. It's a way of showing a little bit of appreciation for the work that they do. It basically says if you are in the ambulance industry, if you're a first responder, paramedic like myself, firefighter, EMT, that if you work 20 hours a week less, either on duty or on call, then you'd be allowed to deduct at least twice a week, $15 a day for your meals. If you work more than 20 hours a week, more than 20 hours a week on call, then you would be able to deduct, do this four times a week, $15 a day for your meals. Where this comes from, members, is I felt most of you know, for the record, I'm a paramedic. I've been a professional law for 27 years. I work for probably the busiest, one of the busiest level one trauma centers in the state. We have really busy run volumes. We average about 55,000 calls a year. Typical day for me, I punch in and I'm not even out of the garage before we get our first call. And oftentimes we'll run 8, 10, 12, sometimes 14 hours, pretty much nonstop. It's a life I'm not complaining about, it's a life that I chose, and that's how I'm wired. Mine is not the only service that is that busy. We have other services. We have seven major ones here in the greater metro area that have similar call volumes. Those would include Healthy's, St. Paul Fire, Edina Fire, Alina, Laconia, North Memorial, and Henry County. So what I'm trying to do here is where this came from is a few years back, I was doing my taxes, like a good citizen. And as I was digging through, after further paperwork, and I'm digging through the books, and I noticed that it said if you're in the transportation industry that you can deduct your meals. And this little funny little bulb went on in my head, and I said, hey, I'm in the transportation industry. So I went and I sat there, I went through all my records, and I deducted all of my meals for the year. And then all of a sudden I realized that, you know, that little voice that's in the back of your head that says, not yet, okay, make a call. So I did. I called the IRS, and I was really excited about this. And in my conversation with them, their question was, are you in the transportation industry? Of course I am. And as we got to talk, they found out, well, you're technically not in the transportation industry. And I said, well, what do you mean? My uniform says medical transportation and transport people to the hospital. They said, no, you have to be a trucker or you have to transport anything but people, pretty much. I lost a big deduction on it, and I wasn't real happy because I spent most of the day digging through my records, all my McDonald's receipts. Anyway, so that discouraged this, you know, a little distrustful. I just kind of found that in the back of my head, and I thought, well, someday if I could do something to help fellow paramedics and EMTs and firefighters, I will. And today is that day. I didn't get this physique. I won't go there. Anyway, most folks, though, what they don't realize is that there's this, we don't have a lot of time to eat, and there's this conception in the movies that all your paramedics and all your firefighters and all your first responders, we have this great camaraderie where we sit around in the kitchen and somebody makes something, and we all eat together, and it's all great. Sometimes that does happen, but I can tell you members, the last time I had a sit-down meal at work, at a place that served food was 1997. So most of the time what we do is that I've got a cooler, it's about this big, I bring it with me, and I eat in the front seat of my truck, and yes, it's in violation of OSHA standards. We are not allowed to eat in our vehicles, however, if you don't do that, then you don't eat. So that's the life I chose, and that's what we do. So what I'm trying to do here is if we do stop and get something to eat, we just be able to deduct it from our taxes. I know the question is going to come up, is there a fiscal note for this? Yes, one has been requested. As we all know, that the department has been barraged. I've been waiting a couple of weeks now. They will have one. I will have it for the tax committee. The initial number I was given was about, it would cost about, you know, we're deducting the $15, the actual cost would be about $2. That's what I was told. That's the ball that I have running with right now. And I will have more information on that when I hit tax committee, because I'm sure that they'll want more information on that. And then just as a side note, other businesses that include deductions for other folks that are in professional trades, or businesses, they can deduct their travel expenses, which include food, fuel, parking, entertainment, etc. And that is not the case with your emergency medical services workers. With that, members, that's the goal, and I stand for your questions.
Representative Shaw. Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Representative Newberger, I like your direction that you're going. The only difference that I have is I'm not the biggest fan of the deductions, and you know, because it would complicate. We need to make our tax code a lot less complicated. So we're not running this through the EMSRB or through the regional programs and put together a budget for it. And then let the regional programs. So if I'm working, if I have a small town ambulance service in Clear City and they're going to go on and on over lunch hour, then they can submit to their local service and just get a check for it at the end of the year. Or whatever it is, create the account. Forget the credit so that they have to take care of it themselves so they can turn it in, submit it to the 8 regional programs, and just pay for it. I mean, I like where you're going. I like the idea, but why not? Why not just try to hide? I mean, when you say you're going to do a tax credit, we're paying for it. That's what it is. I mean, you're going to pay for someone's bill, and I think it's a great idea because it's something that we can do to help, especially in greater Minnesota, to keep people willing to do this service for us. It's a great idea. Why not just set up a bill and say, you know what, we need $500,000 a year to disseminate to the 8 EMS regional programs throughout the state so that they can operate the finances of this and send this out to the locals to deal with it. Or to the MSRB and someone just submits it in monthly.
Representative Newberger. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Sean, that's some excellent points. Suffice to say, if you are getting some kind of a reimbursement for your meals, whether it's a tax deduction or if it's through the MSRB, as you would say, if you're going to be receiving funds, you're going to have to declare that on your taxes anyway. So one way or another, it's going to get tied up with taxes. That would be my belief. Correct me if I'm wrong.
No, Mr. Chair, that's a tax exempt. You don't have to declare that. That's not income. That's reimbursement of your expenses. So.
Representative Ball.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And frankly, I see no problem with the fact that unreimbursed expenses. It's not like these people get a stipend, get highly compensated, because this does include other groups that don't have the streams, don't have the funds to give them that stipend for lunch, as you're suggesting. And so what it does is it decreases income for, unreimbursed things that other companies, other organizations, and frankly, somebody hauling goods should not be treated better than someone hauling your neighbor or a child or a mother or a grandparent to on a medical emergency. So frankly, if we can't see that transportation of inanimate objects deserves something, and transportation of people in crisis, in need, don't deserve that same treatment, I think we need to get a new prescription on our glasses.
Mr. Chair.
Let's go back.
Well, I appreciate that, but I think I need to direct that since that was directed at me.
Okay, go ahead.
Representative Clark, you and I are saying the same thing, except you know what I'm saying? Why should we wait and make those people wait until the end of the year? Let them get reimbursed once a month or every 2 weeks, because those people might be out hauling your neighbors and kids, and frankly, as you put it, they don't have a lot of money sometimes because they don't have a high income, and they're willing to do this for us. So maybe every 2 weeks they should get reimbursed instead of once a year to see the deduction come off their taxes, which may not make that much of a difference, or they can take the standard deduction and don't put it in anyway. So my point is, I agree with the representative Clark. Create the account, pay for it, let people get reimbursed so they can get the check right away, because 1 week they might be out having runs over lunch every single day. The next week they might not. And that will cost them money. So let's do that. Either way, I like what Representative Newberger is doing because it's going to be a good attraction to our services. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess maybe I'm looking at people that are part of volunteer ambulance services that are doing this, and my son, my wife, when they were doing it, got paid nothing up front, nothing. They went through the expenses. They did the activity, and they definitely qualified as unreimbursed, expenses. So while you might be looking at in your area, you've got a highly paid, professional group doing it. In greater Minnesota, we rely on a lot of volunteer ambulance services and personnel that aren't being paid. There's not a revenue stream to give them an extra $15 here or there.
but frankly, given the fairness of equal treatment in the tax code, I think would at least be something. Because again, in greater Minnesota, a lot of people get basically nothing.
Mr. Chair,
one more time, your representative.
No, go ahead, back and forth.
And then I promise.
Okay,
go ahead.
Representative Quinn, we're saying the same thing. Is Representative Newberger, your bill is those folks that have 20 hours a week or less, right? So not full time people. Correct?
Representative Newberger. Mr. Chair, if you're 20 hours a week or less, it's $15 a day twice a week. If you're 21 hours a week or more, it's $15 four times a day.
So it covers everybody. So Representative Quinn, especially for your areas, is exactly what I'm talking about, folks that don't get any money. Create the account. So that that your family or my family back home that does this stuff can submit monthly, bi-weekly, quarterly. We're saying the same thing. Big up to you.
I'll represent you for a possible representative or was.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And my comment on this, Representative Sean, is that there is a difference. One, we're talking in credit as we're proposing, which is full reimbursement. And Representative Newberger is proposing a deduction, which has the effective net effect of the marginal tax rate. In the case of the professional, we're not talking about poverty wages here. I think it's more self-policing, as Representative Newberger has presented, because you'll be mindful of what you're spending anyway, and you'll get a refund based on your marginal income tax rate. If it's a full reimbursement, then we're talking about levying the money from someone else and redistributing that in the form of a direct credit or payment. So I support what Representative Newberger is doing.
Mr. Chair, could this be classified as a food fight?
Yes.
More questions? Any public testimony? Representative Newberger, would you like to redo your motion?
I would, Mr. Chair. And in closing, Representative Sean, you make some really good points, and that is clearly something I'm absolutely open to. As you and I both know right now, the MSRB is in a state of flux, and I think that something of this order might be a little bit more than we should ask of them at this time. That's clearly something that I would be willing to discuss and work on in the future, but right now I'd just like to do something to kind of get this rolling. And members, just a final point before I move this bill. What's in this for me? A lot of people are like, well, you work in this industry. Well, that's true. But truth be told, after 27 years, I've got maybe 2 years left in me. So by the time this comes around for me to really take advantage of it, I'll be gone. So I'm trying to do this for folks coming after me. And with that, members, I move this to the next committee.
Okay, Representative Newberger removes his motion. And for House File 1463, it passed in the Board of Taxes. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Anything? Is Representative Garofalo here yet? If not, we'll move to Representative Winkler. Representative Winkler, House File 322. You want to move your bill?
Mr. Chair, I would move that House File 322 be moved to the General Register.
Okay, Representative Winkler has moved this bill, and we'll have Representative Winkler with the testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for that. Hopefully, thank you for the page and pass that over. Mr. Chair, this bill is commonly referred to as a DWI bill, but it isn't really a DWI bill at all. It was passed the House last session. It did not pass the Senate. And what the bill does today is to clarify in Minnesota statute what the words of the Minnesota Constitution are universally understood to mean by courts in other states, attorneys general who reviewed this, and in fact, our own attorney general. However, just because there is general understanding amongst those who examine court opinions from other states or attorney general opinions about what the words in the Constitution mean. Doesn't mean it is necessarily clear to law enforcement, to legislators, or to members of the public. And the purpose of the bill is not to remove the get-out-of-jail-free card that legislators used to get. It is not to address the DWIs. The purpose is to provide clarity in Minnesota law with respect to legislators' so-called immunity rights. So just to give you a little bit of background, I asked the page to distribute the opinion from Attorney General Swanson from last April. And if you turn to the second to last paragraph on the last page, she clarifies, or she summarizes her opinion, which is that under almost any court, published court opinion that has reviewed this issue, and under any, virtually any attorney general opinion that has reviewed this issue in other states, legislators, in fact, do not have immunity from arrest for criminal violations. However, the attorney general notes that under the circumstances, she believes would be helpful and beneficial for the Minnesota legislature to give additional direction to legislative members of the public, law enforcement, and the courts by enacting legislation to clarify that state legislators have no immunity from arrest for criminal activity. And Mr. Chair, another document that I passed around is something that I printed off from the Minneapolis Police Department. It's a policy from their policy procedural manual, and I'm not in law enforcement, so I can't speak to whether every officer has memorized every page in this manual or not, but it does specifically refer to legislative immunity. And the policy states that officers shall observe legislators' privilege from arrest as set forth in the Constitution without providing any clear guidance as to what that means or how that would be implemented or how that would be used in day-to-day reality. So, Mr. Chair, what I'm asking is that the committee act favorably on House File 322, not because I think legislators are commonly using their so-called immunity to avoid arrest in the case of drunk driving, but because I think it is important that we provide clarity to law enforcement, the public, and ourselves that, in fact, no such immunity exists, and we do not need to wait for the Minnesota Supreme Court to issue a final order interpreting this section of the Constitution before that law is clarified in Minnesota. And so that's the purpose. And I do have some testifiers. These are the Concordia students have been raising this issue for years and trying to get it passed.
Okay, Representative, thank you very much for your testimony. And whichever one of you would like to begin, state your name and who you represent. Go ahead.
Good morning, and thank you, Chairman Cornish, members of Public Safety Committee. My name is Chris Plotch, and I'm joined here today by my classmates, Adam Woods and Claire Hauser. I'd like to thank Representative Winkler for chief authoring House File 322. We also would like to thank our House co-authors in the Senate, our companion bills, chief authored by Senator Lopez. We'd like to thank our co-authors there also. Concordia University has a track record of passing legislation throughout the years. We are very passionate about this bill and being part of the legislative process. Most of you are very familiar with the Legislator Immunity Act, as it is known. This bill was heard in 2012 and 2014 with zero to little opposition. Unfortunately, in 2012, the bill did not get a floor vote but passed through all committees. Last year, the bill passed through three committees and was passed on the House floor. We hope to get this vote again, or to get this passed through this year. Today, we'd like to speak about new information gathered regarding the legislation, support for it, and need for it to get passed. Minnesota Attorney General Louis Swanson, as you returned, has offered her official legal opinion saying legislative action must be taken.
Thank you very much, sir. And ma'am, you state your name and we are sent for
it. I'm Claire Hauser, Courtney St. Paul. We feel it is fair to say that Attorney General Swanson gives opinions only on issues she feels strongly about. Since Walsh, no Minnesota appellate court has construed Article 4 of Section 10. If the Minnesota appellate courts were presented with this issue, it is highly likely they would adopt the majority view set forth in modern cases and find no legislative privilege from arrest for DUIs and DWIs or other criminal activity under Minnesota Constitution. Having said this, I should note that since the 1980s, the Minnesota Secretary of State has issued a wallet-sized personal certificate to each Minnesota legislator, stating that the legislator is entitled to a privilege from arrest in quoting Article 4, Section 10 of the Minnesota Constitution. Because legislators are issued an election certificate to clarify their election, it appears that the wallet-sized certificate card must be given intended to serve some additional purpose, presumably to be issued in a situation involving an arrest. Additionally, since your adjournment, our former Secretary of State, Mark Ritchie, stopped printing new ID cards with the immunity provision printed on the back of the card. We have met with Secretary of State Steve Simon, and his office has continued this practice. But he agrees with us that the legislation change is needed, as the provision is still in law, and in fact, many legislators still have the cards and have shown us, along with old legislators who have now turned to lobbyists.
Thank you for your testimony and also for being friends on Facebook. And so, again, state your name and your state.
Thank you. My name is Ben Wilson from Concordia University, St. Paul. According to the National Highway Traffic Administration, every 97 seconds, a person is injured in a drunk driving-related crash. The Legislative Immunity Act of 2015 will ensure that every Minnesotan is held to the same standard. Driving safe should be everyone's responsibility, including your state legislatures, and we know the majority of the legislatures will never think of using this outdated privilege to support our legislation. A few quick points that we've worked hand-in-hand with the reviser on is, as I'm sure you know, session in law is defined as opening day to closing day, not just one session day to or from home. We're not changing the Constitution, we are redefining the bridge of peace. A few folks have raised the question about not getting arrested but being prosecuted post-session. We've talked to multiple attorneys who agree with us that sufficient evidence will not be present to prosecute a DWI if proper tests are not taken immediately. Yes, you may get the on-site breath test, but a complete blood test at the police station or hospital emergency room is the only official blood test that can be put into evidence. We were also taught last year that if a police officer would take a legislator into custody for suspicion of drunk driving, legally, he or she could be charged with a gross misdemeanor for doing so. Additionally, please note that as recently as this year, a Kentucky legislator who was driving drunk contested his arrest based on the exact same language that is used in the Minnesota's language today. As legislators and representatives of the people of this very state, we thank you for your long, tiresome, and often thankless work that you do. We recognize that the majority of you would not think of using such privilege and avoid the law or act criminally. What we do ask is that you continue the process of equality and integrity by passing this bill, redefining the term bridge of peace. By doing so, you will show the clear dedication to safety and respect for your fellow citizens we know you all have.
Okay, thank you very much for your testimony, Representative Dean.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and to the testifiers. You know, it's a really, really interesting conversation that we've been hearing, and over the past few weeks I've heard it brought up, and I believe that one of you mentioned that, you know, legislators still use this card today, even though no cards have been issued. Now, I look at my card, and my card says that I'm entitled to the privileges stated on the back of this card until January 2015. So my card is no longer valid. So, and I think we need to be really, really careful about how we talk about this, because the Secretary of State is not issuing new cards. So in essence, anyone that has a card, it's expired. So there really aren't people out there with cards. And I just wanted to add that for clarity, Mr. Chair, because I've heard this discussion over and over again, that people still have the opportunity to use their cards. I've never heard anyone say in that conversation, however, the cards have expired, and the cards actually do have the date in which they've expired on them. So I just need to add that for clarification.
Thank you for that clarification. I think we agree that the cards have expired, but the need for the law is still on the books because it's still in effect. So thank you very much. I appreciate it. Representative of the U.S. Service, Representative Holland, Representative Rosenthal.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Representative Winkler. My concern actually comes into
section 2.1 and 2.6, and where you're going to have, if someone gets, let's see a representative from the good northwest angle up there in Lincoln Woods County and gets pulled over for speeding. Is there anything there that wouldn't now require that officer to turn to the sergeant at arms of the House of Representatives?
Oh, Representative, Mr. Chair, Representative Powell, I frankly don't. In my personal opinion, sections 1 and 2 of the bill are not really necessary. But this went through a long, long committee process and discussion in the last session. And these sections of the bill are based on that back and forth. And I was not an advocate for those. But the point is, what Section 2 tries to address is that a licensed peace officer can lose their license, their ability to work in their field, if they detain a legislator from being able to conduct their official business because they would be guilty of a gross misdemeanor. And when you have a law that we have a constitutional provision whose meaning is not necessarily clear to everyone, and you have law enforcement officials who could potentially lose their ability to work in that field and be guilty of a gross misdemeanor if they were to interfere with the legislature, I think you create a potential chilling effect on their willingness to engage. And so what we tried to do in this language was to clarify that it's only a gross misdemeanor if they delay or arrest somebody for the purpose of preventing them from getting to the legislature, not for the need to enforce the law. And so when we made that change in Section A, the corresponding change was also made in Section B to clarify that while you would be guilty of a gross misdemeanor for intentionally delaying or preventing a legislator from voting, you also have an obligation to make sure that if there is official business that needs to be conducted, that you're not unintentionally delaying them. And therefore, the language requires you to move in an expedited manner to make sure that they are able to get to where they need to be.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative, I think this is over. And this is probably my main issue with the bill. I can't support it just because I think that's a ridiculous section. I don't have a problem with many other things today. I don't think it. I think it's a moot point. I agree that the cards are existent and invalid. I actually think that the cards in the Constitution, I believe it was originally, if I remember correctly, in House research last year, they indicated that this was that constitutional provision was back when civil law actually was much more. Used arrest much more often, and that's what I believe that House research came up with. That's where the constitutional effect was put in place, was for civil arrest and civil subpoenas. And I think if we put something in there to clarify that that's what it's for, I think it would be much, I sort of much clearer purpose than this. But if we would take out 2.1 to 2.6, I think I might even open the vote for it, but in its current structure, I can't go there.
Representative Rosenthal, Wilson, and Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Representative Winkler, and to the Concordia students. Thank you for your fortitude. I know you had a rough time last year, and I'm glad to see you back. You know, this bill passed off the House floor with a huge bipartisan vote. And was held up in the Senate. I guess Representative Winkler's question is to you. Have you been in contact with the Senate author and what are the prospects in the Senate this year?
Mr. Chair, Representative Rosenthal, the Senate author last term was Senator Sharon. This year it is Senator Ingebrigtsen. I know that my senator, Senator Lass, shares the Judiciary Committee is not a fan of this bill and does not intend to schedule for a hearing. So I think in order for this bill to have a path, it would be ready to move through the House and possibly be offered as a floor amendment in the Senate or through some other means in the Senate in order to
get it passed by that body. I think the issue is when it comes up to a vote, it's challenging for legislators to vote against this for pretty obvious reasons. And so the goal we have is to get some kind of vote in the Senate so that there's, you know, they have a choice between moving this forward or being in public record against it.
Representative Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Winkler, so correct me if I'm wrong, but aren't you only making the immunity in this provision, eliminating immunity under the DWI section?
Mr. Chair, Representative Wilstrom, Section 3 of the bill clarifies that a fine, including felony, gross misdemeanor, or misdemeanor constitutes breach of peace for purposes of the Minnesota Constitution, Article 4, Section 10. So I think it would cover any felony, gross misdemeanor, or misdemeanor.
Thank you, Representative Winkler. I just wanted to clarify that because the actual recommendation was that your legislation should make clarification so that the state legislators know they have no immunity from arrest for any criminal activity, including the crime of DWI. And I just wanted to make sure that that's actually the way that you have it written and that that's the way folks understand it. I just see that it's amending Chapter 169.79, and I wanted to make sure folks understood that it's all crimes, not just DWI crimes.
Mr. Chair, Representative Wilstrom, you're more an expert in this area than I am, but I think we actually worked on this language together last session, and it's my understanding that's what it does. If anybody thinks it needs to be improved upon in any way, I'm more than willing to do that.
Okay, Representative
Johnson. Thank you, Mr. Representative. It might need to be amending a different chapter to make it more clear, because being 169, you might want to put it someplace else. Just approving that person's cap.
Representative Johnson. Mr. Chair, Representative Weber. In Section 8, the document delivering the number to the Sergeant at Arms as strictly deals with an alcohol-related offense, is that correct?
Mr. Chair, Representative Johnson, it's my understanding, based on the fact that it's 169A, that that is likely the case. Of course, somebody else could even, we don't know how 169A might be changed or amended in the future, but that is my understanding. I guess, I mean, the point of Section B is if a legislator is driving drunk and they're arrested, they should be arrested, they shouldn't be driving, and they should be delivered to whatever address we think it's better to vote than it is to drive. But what the point is that they're to be delivered to the legislature so that they can sober up and conduct their duties in accordance with their oath and their demands for their positions.
Thank you, Mr. Winkler. So the person is up in LA County getting charged under this Section B. They probably would not be making the vote at that time as well. Some possible way for them to get down here to vote if you're already in down here to vote.
Well, Mr. Chair, Representative Johnson, the board can be held open for as long as the speaker wants the board held open.
Okay, I just want to make my clarification for Representative Hoffman that Section D is with alcohol-related offense. All right, public testimony. Of the students in this area who dealt with us a year ago. There's this Supreme Court case that we have been following in our law enforcement training for years. We have numerous examples of where unfortunately, first of all, we don't want to arrest legislators because they don't do anything wrong. But if they do, if the caliber of records shows contrary, if they do, we will have arrest. And we can even come to the Capitol, call them off from the House floor, and arrest them. To be clear, law enforcement will do what we have to do.
if there needs to be more clarity from the legalese in this, we cops got it. You want more clarification, we're not opposed to it. But we do have concerns about, if we pick somebody up the way this is written, delivering them from northern Minnesota or anywhere to here. Now, if we have state control assets and resources, we'd be happy to turn over them and use plane flying down to be much quicker. But we just have concerns about the logistics and some of the wording here. We're happy to work on it in the future. We don't think it's going to really play on the other side. But be clear, we will take action. We hope it never happens. But if it needs more clarification, we're willing to work on it.
Okay, thank you, Director.
Mr. Chair,
I know that this is, this is my fifth term now. I think we can handle an amendment on the fly here for those nonpartisan staff. And so I wonder, even though it's contrary to committee rules, we could offer an amendment to clarify the section of statute as Representative Wilson raised and Mr. Deeblood has got that on the hand.
We can change the rules anytime we like. What I would like to do with the presentation proof of the lead Representative Wilson.
Can you want to talk about your chair, Mr. Chair? It's on line 2.7. Instead of move to strike 169A.79 and insert 609.0255.
Okay, go ahead, Mr. Deeble.
Great.
Everybody understand that? And what does that mean, Mr. Deeble?
Mr. Chair, members, as originally drafted, this bill was focused on defining breach of peace as to not include DW or to include DWI. So I think when it was expanded to all offenses, they didn't change the location of where the provision was placed in the statute, which was logically put in places at A, the DWI statute. Now that it applies to all offenses, it should be at 69, which is the general credit chapter.
Right, members, I would encourage a yes vote on this bill. It's one that I previously carried. I think regardless if they get arrested or not, or how the sheriff's station or anybody else handles it, I think it's nice just to have this language as it goes. Anywhere we should get rid of it and give the public the confidence that DWI or any offense from a legislator, they should be held accountable. So any other testimony or questions? Public testimony. Did we get it on the amendment? It's the oral amendment. And everybody understood it, I think. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Mayor, thank you. Oh, that doesn't help.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I would hope that maybe as this moves forward, we can definitely take a look at that sections 2.1 and 2.6. And I just don't think we need it. I think everything else works.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair, Representative Howe. I'd be more than happy to delete all of Section 2. I'm just trying to reflect the concerns of other legislators and wanting to make sure that there would not be any intimidation or undue delay in processing legislators if they're trying to conduct their official business. But, you might talk to Representative Lash if you guys want to drop them.
Mr. Chair,
Representative Holmes,
thanks. I don't know if you were looking at B. The section that I would pertain to, I think the rest of it is fine, and I just don't think we should require those law enforcement officers to. And we don't need anything been drinking and pulled over. I don't think we want them here anyway, so I think I'm good with just leaving them up there.
We have no issue in our law system for code enforcement.
All right, so let me move on so we can get to another bill here from Representative Garofalo. So, Representative, do you want to move your motion in?
Mr. Chair, I renew my motion to House Files 322B, referred to the General Register.
Yes, amended. Okay, for the motion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much, Representative. Hopefully, they have courage in the Senate today. Representative Garofalo, I'll move your bill since I, the author, will be forward to support House File 1085.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker and members. First of all, there are two amendments. I just wanted to make sure I can't move the amendments, but I believe Representative Constantine will be moving. I'd like him to move the 815 through 126 amendment. He can explain it. He has a technical change to it as well, Mr. Chairman.
First, to get it in the shape of the author wants it.
Yes.
There's an additional name on the A1 amendment. Jack won't love me if we can change the rules for the 24 hour, but Representative Garofalo would like to have Jack won Deputy's name also moved into it. So, I think that's the second. Sorry, got the wrong one.
So, Mr. Chairman, members, the A1 amendment was brought to me by the State Patrol. Make sure we're not accidentally making street racing okay or anything like that. So, that's the intent of the amendment.
Okay. You've moved the A1 amendment. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, now we'll bring up the A15-0126 amendment. And President Constantine, what was your hearing? Go ahead.
Okay, sorry, I got the backwards there. Add Jack one deputy's name to the bill.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, and Mr. Representative Constantine can supply that to nonpartisan staff. The intent is that under Section 5, where it currently says Thomas Constantine, and also about line 1.4, where it says Thomas Constantine, the name Jack one deputy and would appear for both those names. And the name is in writing, Representative Constantine can give it to staff.
Okay, for the amendment, 815-0126 is amended. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, now you have the bill in the shape you want, so let's go ahead and do this one.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I want to thank you for your leadership on this issue and appreciate you granting this this bill hearing. It is greatly appreciated by myself and many stakeholders. Members under current law, quite simply, we have a mistake. There is a hole in law for those individuals who are careless in their actions of driving or their actions result in death or great bodily harm to another individual. Under current law, we have a choice of applying either a misdemeanor statute or a felony statute in this area. And the unintended consequences of this is that the felony statute is a very difficult legal standard to prove. And we've had many examples across the state of Minnesota. The careless actions of a driver have resulted in the death of another individual, and those actions have been charged as simply a misdemeanor, which is akin to running over a street sign. I will tell you that about once every 4 or 5 months, I get a phone call or an email because my name pops up as being the previous author of this bill, and members of the public simply do not understand how they can lose a loved one as a result of the careless actions of another individual, and that is the same type of punishment as if a street sign has been run over. The fiscal note before you shows no fiscal note. This bill has bipartisan support, and what it does is it creates a third tier in between a gross misdemeanor statute so they can have held. There's an option of charging and penalizing or providing additional penalties in those situations where careless driving results in the death or great bodily harm of another individual. I believe there are multiple testifiers here who wish to testify, but that is the bill in a nutshell. I would ask for members.
Mr. Chairman and members, my name is Magwood. I am State Coordinator for Green Bay in Minnesota, a famous acronym for American Bikers Awareness, Training, and Education. We're the largest motorcycle advocacy group in the state of Minnesota. And I very much appreciate you hearing this bill. I appreciate the member support of authors and new authors. And my purpose in testifying today is to let all the members of this committee know that ABA of Minnesota is 100% behind this bill. If there's no questions for me, I will turn it over to the people who can speak to the technical and personal experience aspects of this. Mr. Chairman, thank you for this, and members, please vote yes on this bill.
Well, thank you, Mr. Magnon, for all the work you've put on to it since the start years ago. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
And who would like to testify first? I'll welcome the committee and state your name and your organization again.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Nancy Johnson, and I'm representing Minnesotans for Safe Driving. This legislation has been a priority for my organization and many other organizations for over 10 years. Thankfully, the number of traffic fatalities have dropped substantially in the last 11 years, from 657 to 387. Injuries have increased by 10,000 people in that same time period, even though more people are driving on our roads. Driving impaired by alcohol and drugs was the cause of 50% of the fatalities 30 years ago, and now accounts for only 33%. That means that the non-alcohol-related crashes are making up 67% of fatalities. What brought down the percentage of alcohol-impaired drivers involved in crashes was tough laws, educational awareness, and substantial legal penalties. The next step is to address the driving of that 67%. One way is to change the public's perception that these crashes are just accidents. Most are not. Speeding, aggressive driving, failure to yield, sleeping at the wheel, texting, distracted driving such as using the cell phone, reading the paper, putting on makeup, having your mind on something else besides driving, and just not seeing the car ahead of you or the person crossing the street, to name a few, are all the actions that are causing these crashes. The prosecution has a leeway as to how to charge each crash. They can decide to charge, they can decide not to charge, charge a traffic violation, charge reckless driving, or if they have enough proof for gross negligence, they can charge the felony. What is missing from this list is a middle ground charge of gross misdemeanor. This legislation is asking for a gross misdemeanor to come from the enhancement of the careless driving statute if death or serious injury is a result of this negligent chargeable crash. This change provides the system with a much-needed tool for appropriately recognizing culpability of these intermediate offenders, those who act with simple negligence instead of gross negligence, but who kill or greatly injure people through that negligence. Currently, prosecutors are left to choose whether to pursue this category of offender with the harshness of a felony or the inappropriate leniency of a misdemeanor. In the case of an intermediate offender, that leaves the prosecutor with maybe two inappropriate choices. In some cases, this might mean that the intermediate offender is charged more harshly than the prosecutor for the felony, or means that the prosecutor charges just the misdemeanor for someone who kills multiple people. An intermediate punishment is necessary to appropriately deal with these intermediate offenders. It also impresses upon society drivers that increasingly use their cell phones to send text messages and emails, make calls, or even play video games while they're driving. That there are serious consequences. This bill is more important now than it ever has been before. Many of these cases involve substantial amounts of restitution. The additional year of probation can play a key role in providing courts, probation officers, and prosecutors with a tool for obtaining that restitution. If the defendant refuses or makes little effort to pay restitution while still on probation, the courts are in a much better position to provide the incentive, maybe jail time or the imposition of other conditions, to enforce the restitution order. Once the probation expires, the courts have a much more difficult time enforcing payment of restitution to victims. Extending probation to 2 years may also allow courts and probation officers to provide defendants with more realistic timetables to pay back this restitution, 2 years instead of one. An inconsistency currently exists so far as we treat negligent driving resulting in no harm as equally culpable to negligence reviving resulting in someone being killed or seriously injured when the culpability level is so different. This bill would resolve that inconsistency. We believe the gross misdemeanor charge will only be applied to a small number of crashes resulting from negligent driving. It should not be overused, but in those cases in which it is appropriate, it will avoid the unworkable felony or misdemeanor scheme that currently exists. It is also noteworthy to emphasize how frustrated prosecutors feel and how angry victims' families become when the victim or surviving member is told that the person who killed or injured them will only be charged with a misdemeanor and prepare them for the eventuality that the offender will receive little more than a slap on the wrist. Minnesota is working hard on their TCD program towards zero deaths, and the only way the fatalities will continue to decrease is to strongly address the driving behavior of all drivers who cause crashes, whether they are impaired by alcohol or drugs, or impaired by distraction, inattentive driving, or intentionally breaking the traffic laws. We hope that you will vote yes on this bill.
Thank you, Dan. And any questions yet to have over the show?
Just a comment, Mr. Chair, and I appreciate Representative Garofalo, I am also a co-author on this bill, and we suffered a tragedy in my district. A family suffered a loss and approached me on this topic, and this is a great tragedy whenever this happens. And their son unfortunately lost his life as a result of this, so this is a good bill.
Thank you, Representative. And your next testifier. If you want to state your name and organization, you can.
Good morning, Chair and members. Thank you for allowing me to speak. My name is Kathy Sakura. This bill is very near and dear to my heart, as well as countless others who have lost loved ones too soon because of negligent drivers. Our son Lance was killed on May 2nd, 2003, on his way home from work. He was riding his motorcycle for the first time. It was a beautiful spring Friday evening, and he took back roads home in an effort to avoid highway traffic. Not only did Lance leave behind us, he left behind a wife who at the time was 9 months pregnant, and his wife was 9 months pregnant, and a daughter who was now reaching her 12th birthday, and never had the opportunity to meet her dad or have a new dad in her life. You see, the driver was in a hurry. He was running late to meet some friends. He was on his way and realized that he forgot his phone at a friend's house and turned around to get it. He wasn't paying attention. He was distracted, and he made a left-hand turn directly in front of our son Lance. Lance was killed instantly. He didn't have a chance. In a mere second, our lives and countless others' lives changed. They changed forever. The prosecuting attorney struggled with how to charge this driver for the heinous crash that he caused since alcohol wasn't a factor. This young driver was charged with careless driving, which is a misdemeanor, improper change of course, a petty misdemeanor, failed to yield to a right-of-way, a misdemeanor, inattentive driving, a misdemeanor, and illegal starting, a misdemeanor. 90 days or $1,000 was the maximum that he could receive for this crash. This driver had no remorse the whole time through the trial. The consequences of this tragedy weren't enough to enough for him, or even severe enough, that he took it seriously. He made a mockery of the justice system by not following his sentence, resulting in a violation of probation. A warrant was eventually issued for his arrest. After the perseverance of the Minneapolis Police Department, he ended up in the workhouse for 1 week. The driver who killed Lance walked away. According to public records, this driver has been convicted of 7 additional driving offenses since then. But yet he continues to live his life, and he continues to receive misdemeanors. We live our lives without our precious son, husband, daddy, grandson, brother. It's just not right. The present law really doesn't allow higher charges unless alcohol or drugs were involved. It is unacceptable to us as the survivors of fatality of serious injury or a crash causing death by breaking other laws is only a mere misdemeanor and carries the $1,000 maximum fine or 90 days. Please help provide prosecutors with an informed tool by creating an intermediate charge of gross demeanor for intermediate offenders. We need to change the public's perception that there are not serious consequences for breaking traffic regulations that result in these types of crashes. These are not accidents. They could be avoided. This legislation is extremely important to us, the surviving victims. We need your support, concern, and help to bring awareness so that we, survivors and victims, feel that the criminal justice system believes in the seriousness of traffic crashes involving a death or serious injury. Again, due to the lack of serious consequences for the driver that killed my son, he continues to drive recklessly. I truly believe if this bill will pass into law, creating more severe penalties for those who choose a distraction of a phone, texting, or are in too big of a hurry and become negligent and downright reckless, would think twice before making such a choice. There's nothing that would make me happier as we approach the 12-year anniversary of my son's death. As tragic as it was, and untimely that this bill get passed, again, I'm respectfully requesting that you would help support this bill.
Thank you very much, Matt, for your testimony. I appreciate it. Any questions? Seeing none, your next testifier, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Dorian Burley. I work for the Bicycle Alliance of Minnesota, a statewide organization that works to educate and advocate for bicyclists. Bicycle Alliance supports House File 1085. We also support the Toward Zero Deaths campaign, but agree with many that the only way to achieve such a goal is to address driving behaviors in a more serious way. As Nancy mentioned, two-thirds of the fatalities on our roads now are not alcohol-related. People simply don't appreciate that there can be, and all too often are, serious consequences to seemingly harmless things like all the things Nancy mentioned. And this is also something that I know from first-hand experience, although I'm lucky. I'm one of the lucky ones. I'm here to talk to you about it. 4 years ago, I was hit in a crosswalk by someone who was charged with and pled guilty to careless driving. The driver was fined $500. I spent 3 weeks in Regents Hospital, and it cost $350,000 to screw me back together. I'm permanently impaired and full of titanium and steel. Most people are shocked to hear that if you kill someone while doing these things, the penalty is only a misdemeanor. That's why the Bicycle Alliance supports this bill to enhance the penalties. We don't want to lock more people up. We want to be part of an education campaign that will help prevent some of these non-alcohol-related fatalities and serious injuries. I don't think we can make progress on these driving behaviors that are causing many of the fatalities or serious injuries without a similar strategy that has been talked about, a similar strategy to the seatbelt and drunk driving. So, House File 1085 will be a great step towards doing that. Without it, we may never live to see the vision of Toward Zero traffic-related deaths. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir. And your next testifier?
Final testifier will be County Attorney Hunter.
Welcome back to the committee, sir. Your name and title?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. James Bash, Dakota County, member of the Board of Directors of the Minnesota County Attorneys Association. I've long been a supporter of this bill. I've testified before this committee on this matter before. I worked with Representative Garofalo and the other organizations you've heard from today over the years as we've sought to make this important change and needed change in our laws. I can tell you that the County Attorneys Association has long supported these changes. And I'm also advised that the City Attorneys
throughout the metropolitan area. We'll prosecute most of the misdemeanor level offenses, as you know, also support this important and needed change. So just try to offer that information, and thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, sir. We have Representative Johnson, and we'll speak to Representative Powell, and then Johnson, and then Representative Powell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I don't know if this is to Representative Garofalo or to some of the legal beagles that we have sitting here, but I'm struggling. I appreciate everything that you've done, except for I don't understand why you didn't take those same provisions and add them to the reckless provision instead of getting rid of reckless. I think reckless really drives a higher requirement or higher. I know it requires a higher requirement to prove, but it's also more damaging on your insurance if you get a reckless. It's almost the same as a DUI. So I guess my question is, why are we getting rid of reckless? Why didn't we just add the same thing to the reckless provision?
Mr. Chairman, Representative, if I understand your question right, you're asking why we don't reckless provision, as you're calling it, that's the felony charging statute, and the legal standard for that is willful negligence, I believe is the correct term. I'm looking at staff, I got that right. Or to not part of the staff. It's a very difficult standard to prove. It basically is one step short of it, Representative Powell. So that's why we're creating this third option in the bill.
Mr. Chair and Representative Howe, are you asking about the reckless driving that is repealed in Section 3?
Yes, I am.
Mr. Chair and members, that provision is still repealed, but the A1 amendment that we added on, if you look on lines 1.3 to 1.6, that language is added back in here. But it would be under the careless driving provision, so you would need to make changes if you want to put it up. Keep it under the reckless.
Mr. Chair, my question hasn't been, I think we still, I don't have a problem providing the option. My concern is you remove the one option. And if there is willful wanton behavior, to me that should be at a higher level. And we should prosecute them at a higher level. Now you're taking away something that should be there, I think, because if we can prove that and we've got that the racing they damaged those folks, they hurt someone, I believe that should be there. I think taking it and moving it, just I don't have a problem with moving that careless piece on a careless, but I think reckless should be there, should be as an appropriate charge in some respects.
Mr. Chair, members, I apologize. I need to correct myself. The provision that we added back in just deals with the racing. We didn't add back in the reckless, willful wanton piece.
Well, we have one more here.
I just want to ask about the
extra on it. Mr. Beck, could you comment on that? Clarify for us what we're talking about. If there is a concern.
Mr. Chair, Representative, in reference to the reckless driving statute, it does require a burden of proof that's very similar to proof of gross negligence. A willful wanton misconduct versus very great negligence to be gross negligence as defined as driving without even skate care. So from a prosecutorial perspective, if you can prove reckless driving, we're basically going to be able to prove gross negligent driving. And that's a felony, which I agree with you, that type of gross negligent conduct should be a higher concern. And it is under the law. And I think that was really the impetus for removing that language. It wasn't to try to say that wasn't appropriate.
But Mr. Baxter, if you still have the capability to charge at a higher rate than more serious, even with this change.
Yes, you will, Mr. Chair. You can charge a felony under the gross negligent standard under the circumstances where the conduct is willful or wanton type behavior.
Okay, Representative Powell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just think we're taking a tool out of the toolbox, and maybe you don't want to go to a felony, but you want to go to I think if you go for one, then now it automatically goes to a felony where, you know, maybe it doesn't go there. I just don't think you should take a tool out of the toolbox. That's my opinion.
You still have prosecutorial discretion to go either way.
We do, Mr. Chair. We can basically still, under his permission, we'd be able to charge if there's careless driving that results in death or great bodily harm, to charge it as a gross misdemeanor. If it's grossly negligent driving conduct that results in death or great bodily harm, we can charge that as a felony. And so there are other levels of it, and we still have the misdemeanor level careless driving for less serious issues.
Representative Johnson. All right, Mr. Chair. I think issues that the representative Hall has, as an officer, I've charged reckless driving numerous times. And reckless is even more serious than passing careless. Because it's willfully doing it and wanting to do it. In fact, all the years of my career, I've never had anybody find a reckless driving ticket in court. And I can't count the number of times I've had a careless driving ticket I had to go for. Testify. I would myself, I would love to see the same provisions in the reckless driving as in the careless, because there is a difference. But I'd also like to see reckless driving raised from a misdemeanor to a careless, or to a gross misdemeanor, because they are two different offenses, and there are definitely more serious offenses between the two. So I struggle with understanding that rule in this bill that we have. But if somebody's racing and I catch them, I'd much rather charge them with reckless driving, and it's going to affect their insurance rates much more than just charging them with careless driving. So I think we need to look at this and really come up and Garofalo work with the others. And I think it's a tool that we have that we need, that law enforcement needs, when nobody gets hurt, but we can really crack down on the situation to stop that person from doing something in the future that might kill or hurt somebody.
Mr.
Chairman, my door always remains open.
My personal experience with this was October 2nd. I was at a funeral when I got a call. And the gentleman in Aiken blew through a stop sign and hit my brother hard enough to roll his Chevy Tahoe. He was pronounced dead on the arrival. My brother, Major Tom Constantine, spent his entire adult life in the Air Force serving his country. He had just retired. He has three children. Three boys that are adults, but he'll never see his grandchildren. My sister-in-law actually has Parkinson's, and we're not real sure how she's going to survive without my brother taking care of her. When I called up to Aiken and they told me that this gentleman was being charged with two misdemeanors, you just got seven, I got two. I went through the roof. This hole needs to be plugged up. I don't think it's unreasonable to do a misdemeanor. If they prove the felony, that's great. The law actually does recognize, these are petty misdemeanors. They are moved to a misdemeanor when they're done in such a way as to endanger the public. I think the next logical step is when they actually kill somebody or maim them badly, that it can be pushed up to a gross misdemeanor. Thank you.
Representative D.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and to Representative Garofalo. I think this is great that we're enhancing penalties. I think the ultimate goal we need to be cognizant of is to make our roads safer, to make it so individuals are not out recklessly driving, carelessly driving, all those things that ultimately, for some individuals, cause bodily harm and other individuals cause death. Is there anything in this bill, or could there be anything in this bill that would actually do some education to folks
I think there are probably a lot of people out there that have no idea what careless driving laws are, or no idea what reckless driving is. And is there anything that we can do as a state to help educate the public about not just the dangers, but about the fact that, you know, should this bill move forward and then it pass, that these are serious penalties that are associated with this type of activities?
Representative Garofalo, we're being televised right now, so I imagine we're trying to work on it. Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman and Representative Dean, by definition, we can always do more than we are doing, regardless of the subject of passing the matter. But I do think an important part of this bill is to understand there is a public education component proactively, but also reactively. When we have these tragedies in the future, that there is an elevated crime, there is prosecutorial discretion. Right now, the message is that a human life is as valuable as a street sign. And I don't think we want to be communicating that message to society. I certainly understand that there are those, and I take the issue very seriously about when we are increasing penalties for those crimes and lack intent. I tread out in this water very carefully to understand those concerns, but at the same time, there has to be accountability in our criminal justice system. And it's happening far too, this issue is happening far too often. And when those people make those choices, they're making choices that cause the great bodily harm or death of another individual, they do need to be held accountable.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Garofalo, I support your bill. When I received bill passed, it was a struggle to get it through. And all the issues that Ms. Johnson brought up, cell phones, makeup, eating, all the other distractions that people do while driving, in some cases end up in these kinds of tragedies. Have you given any thoughts on how you might approach these types of situations as far as educating people and maybe future legislation?
Mr. Chair, Representative Rosenthal, first of all, let me just say this bill has nothing to do with primary seatbelt. And it is not, if you were opposed to primary seatbelt, you're not opposed to my bill. No, it's like the worst statement of support I've ever heard. That being said, I am happy to any time what our responsibility as legislators is to make sure that citizens have access to the facts and understand things. My door remains open, of course, I'm willing to do that process. It's a journey, not a destination. Mr. Rosenthal, please just get off the
Mr. Chair, thank you, Representative Garofalo, for the compliment. I just see every day, driving home from the Capitol, you know, people veering all over the road, and most of the times I'm cell phone is on scene, and I'm just trying to pick up. Any public questions? Seeing none. I'm going to do my motion to pass House File 1085 as amended to the agenda order. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for the hearing and for the public presentation.
Okay,